So a couple of weeks ago, I had the privilege, the opportunity to go down to Southern Oregon for a four-day little retreat with a group of other executive pastors around Spokane and in Oregon, just to go there and get away and kind of iron sharpening iron type of thing. It's a retreat that comes around every year that I try to get to every year with a half a dozen other guys, and it's just it's a great group of guys, men just full of the Holy Spirit, love God, love their church. They're just a wonderful group of men to be able to be around, so fulfilling. Dearly love them, and I've really, really learned a lot from them over the last number of years that I've been able to go down there. It's a great conversation, great time, great food, even a little recreation. We got to go golfing. We headed down Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, we went golfing. Actually, I say golfing. I went with three guys. The other two guys golfed. I played their first nine. The second nine turned into me swinging a club at a ball, hit a house. I hit the ball, and I just went, oh, no, and I turned around, and Bill, one of the other guys I was here, and goes, oh, I didn't see it. What happened? And I just, thinking in my mind, wait for it. Boom. Did not shatter, but boom. Hit either the side of the house or the roof. And he goes, oh, no. And he goes, you going to go look for it? No. Went to the next, got that hole over, went to the next hole, knocked it into the weeds, got it out, knocked it into the weeds, got it out, hit a house. I didn't finish that hole, played the next hole, almost hit a house, but I hit a tree first. And then I quit before I lost my salvation. So the last morning that we were there, we left Friday morning, but we participated in daily devotionals together. The last morning that we were there, Friday morning before we left, we were doing a devotional together at a Colossians 2. And what we did is we took turns as a group, each person reading a verse at a time. So I read a verse, next guy read a verse. And when we came across any part of a verse that contained either Jesus Christ, him, whom, he, or any other variation of the word in reference to Jesus, we would finish the verse and then talk about the verse and how the context of that verse spoke to us. And that would open up a lot of conversation amongst the guys about maybe how that particular verse spoke to us. And what was so neat about the experience was that it gave me a new way of studying the Bible, one that I hadn't really even thought of before. Because there are times that I know for me personally that if I'm not careful, reading the Bible can be almost just words on a page. And sometimes if my mind's running busy, it's a check mark off for the day, and that's absolutely not what it's supposed to be. And so doing this exercise forced us to slow down and really look at each and every verse very carefully. And when we did this, I really began to see exactly how radical this letter from the Apostle Paul to the church in Colossae was. So for instance, one of the verses that I got to read was Colossians 2:15, and it says, "And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross." And what was interesting about this is you sit down, you slow down, and you think about it. The powers and the authorities, what do we think about powers and authorities? The people that we maybe have elected to power, people that have taken power, people that are should be revered, feared, respected, people that we maybe give our influence over to, or we allow them to influence us, have control over us maybe on some level. And so these powers and the authorities, Jesus has made them a public spectacle. When you think about a public spectacle, what made me think about was this down in the town square, they'd have a set of stocks that they would put somebody into, and they would either torture them, ridicule them, whatever, but they were mocked, and they were in the stocks and could do nothing about it. And then what it's saying is Jesus, this is what Jesus took single-handedly, the powers and the authorities made them a spectacle by the cross. And the cross, keep in mind, was a method of torture. You nailed somebody to the cross naked as a way of humiliating them, torturing them, a very prolonged, very horrific death. And so what was meant to be used as shame, Christ used as victory. And it was so cool to just be able to step back and think about that. And our hope with the Encountering Jesus series is the same thing. We want to look at the encounters of that a variety of people had with Jesus in hopes that it would bring forth a livelier context than just words on a page, in hopes that we would all walk away with a deeper understanding of the character of Jesus as well as those who encountered him. And I remember reading my Bible as a new believer and coming to the verse in 1 Timothy where Paul writes that this is a trustworthy saying and everyone should accept it. Christ Jesus came to the world to save sinners, and I am the worst of them all. And I remember sitting at my dining room table at probably 5:30, 6 in the morning, reading this with a cup of coffee, a little bleary-eyed, and thinking to myself, has the severity of sin really changed that much over time? Because I had been in my BC days, I had done some, what I would consider to be some pretty bad things. And even at the time of reading this, I was still struggling with some pretty dark areas in my life. And so I'm sitting here scratching my head, and I'm completely baffled as to what is it that St. Paul could have possibly done to say that he was the worst of all sinners, and in some translations, that he was the chief of sinners. And I honestly thought in reading this that Paul was being maybe a little overtly humble, maybe a little arrogant. But it was because I didn't understand the context of who Paul was or what it was that he was referring to, and I didn't have a grasp on the history that his readers had. But when you begin to realize who Paul was, the things he did before his encounter with Jesus become much, much clearer. And so who was Paul? Well, in his own words, he says, I was circumcised when I was 8 years old. I am a pure-blooded citizen of Israel and a member of the tribe of Benjamin, a real Hebrew if there ever was one. And I was a member of the Pharisees who demand the strictest obedience to the Jewish law. I was so zealous that I harshly persecuted the church, and as for righteousness, I obeyed the law without fault. Okay, so Paul was a Pharisee. And I know Caleb about a month ago spoke on Pharisees a little bit when he did his message on the religious elite. But to help put this into context about who Paul was, who this man named Paul is, I want to turn our attention back to the Pharisees again. So the sect of the Pharisees was thought to have originated roughly around the 3rd century before Jesus, so roughly 300 years before Jesus was born in the days preceding the Maccabean Wars. And this was a time when the Greeks had the dominion over the Jews. And so the Greeks were making an effort to what was called Hellenize the Jews. That is, they wanted to convert the Jews to begin to speak Greek and to accept Greek culture and to embrace Greek worship. And ultimately, there was a strong tendency among the Jews to accept the Hellenization, to accept Greek culture, and accept the pagan religious customs of the Greeks. And not only that, but we see this tendency throughout the entire Old Testament of the Jews kind of conforming to whatever culture they were kind of immersed in at the time. And so the rise of the Pharisees was thought that it was in a reaction and a protest against the tendency of these Jews to Hellenize. The aim of the Pharisees was to preserve the national integrity and the conformity to Mosaic law, or the law of Moses. So the Pharisees are considered by many to be the father of modern-day Judaism. So their main distinguishing characteristic was their belief in oral law that God gave Moses on Sinai with the Torah. So the Torah, which is the written law, we would compare that to, say, the U.S. Constitution in the sense that it laid out a series of laws that were considered to be open to interpretation. So the Pharisees believed that that God gave Moses the knowledge of what these laws meant and how they were to be applied. This oral tradition, which was ultimately passed down from generation to generation to generation, was organized and eventually was written down roughly 3 centuries later into what is now known as the Talmud. So the Talmud, in a very loose, almost crude explanation, is an interpretation of Mosaic law based on the opinion of the early rabbis. So to kind of bring that a little bit closer to home, I would equate it to be like the U.S. Supreme Court decisions based on the interpretation of the Constitution. So you have the Supreme Court justices, you have the rabbis, you have the Constitution, you have the Talmud, and you have the Torah, the written law. And then you have the Supreme Court decisions that are interpreted based on what they believe the Constitution is really saying, and you have the Talmud based on what the rabbis believe that the Torah is really saying. So Paul most likely, when he was growing up, studied both the Torah, the written law, and the Talmud, the oral tradition, under a Pharisee named Gamaliel, who was considered at that time to be one of the very best Jewish scholars around. So according to Christian scholar Anthony Salarini, Pharisees were higher. They had a social class. They were considered to be higher than peasants, but lower than the ruling class. So most of them would be subordinate officials in a government. They would be bureaucrats. They would be judges. They would be teachers. In short, they were retainers who were literate servants of the governing class. So they were interwoven throughout society, not a unified and withdrawn community, but they were immersed in the society in which they lived and had influence in the society in which they lived. And so all of their rulings, all the rulings of the Pharisees, were necessary for the Jews that were trying to live against Roman influence. Salarini also classifies the Pharisees as a reformist sect, one that would seek gradual, divinely revealed alterations in the world. So to break it down further, there's the kind of a very brief overview of the Pharisees. To break it down further, in the generation prior to the birth of Jesus, there were two great rabbis, one named Hillel, one named Shammai. Love of man was considered by Hillel as the kernel of the entire Jewish, as the entire religious, where am I at here? As the entire teaching of the Jewish faith. In fact, Hillel was probably the original author of the Golden Rule, because it was written that there was once a heathen who wished to become a Jew who had asked Hillel for a summary of the Jewish religion in the most concise terms. And Hillel said, "What is faith? What is hateful to thee, do not unto thy fellow man. This is the whole law, the rest is merely commentary." Shammai, on the other hand, was very well known for being strict on both his religious views as well as his actions. And so he is said to have wanted to, at one point, make his son, while he was still just a young child, to adhere to the law of fasting on the Day of Atonement, which was typically something that was reserved for young adults and above. And it was said that he was only dissuaded from actually following through on this because of the insistence of his friends. There was another occasion when Shammai's daughter-in-law gave birth to a baby boy on the Feast of Tabernacles, and Shammai is reported to have broken through the roof of her bedchamber in order to open up the structure to the outdoors so that his newborn grandson would not be in technical violation of the obligations of the festival. And it's been noted that the Hillel party, who was in favor of the Hellenistic bent, was willing to work with Rome as long as they had the opportunity and the religious freedoms to study the Torah. The Shemite Pharisee, on the other hand, was described as a very militant hardliner who was adamantly against any, was completely against working with Rome, regardless of whatever religious freedoms that they were granted. And so Paul, who claimed to have been raised in a Jewish family that had kept the traditions his entire life without fault, was considered to be a very ultra-conservative Jew. It was highly likely that Paul was not of the Hillel Phariseeism, but rather the more radical Shemite party. And so there's the background in the Pharisees. And as we shift our attention now to Paul, who was known as Saul prior to his conversion, I hope you have a little bit better understanding of the history of his beliefs. So Paul was born around the year 5 AD, roughly 10 years after the birth of Jesus, in a city called Tarsus over in south central Turkey. At that point, Turkey was under Roman authority. And so Paul, while born a Jew in his heritage, was also granted Roman citizenship because of where he was born. And at some point in his childhood, Paul would have either by himself or with his family traveled some 645 miles down to Jerusalem, where between the ages of 10 and 15, he began to study Jewish law under the instruction of the Rabbi Gamaliel. Around the age of 26, he joined the Pharisees. Roughly a year after that, we find him in the book of Acts, present at the stoning of Stephen, who was the first recorded Christian martyr, followed then by another two-year mission to begin destroying the church until his encounter with Jesus. So Paul was a bad dude before his encounter with Jesus. In fact, when we look at the resumes of the apostles, Paul stands out as probably the most unique. We talked about Matthew a couple of weeks ago, but Paul is definitely in a class of his own. And using verbiage that we would be more familiar with today, we could make a very strong case that Paul would be considered to be a terrorist. He was pursuing Christians with the intent on placing them in jail and having them killed in hopes of discouraging people from putting their faith into Jesus. And on the day that Stephen was martyred, there was a great persecution that broke out against the Christian church in Jerusalem. And with the exception of the apostles, it scattered all the believers throughout Judea and throughout Samaria. And at that point is when Paul started his mission to begin to destroy the church. And so he would go from house to house. Paul would go from house to house, dragging out entire families by whatever means necessary. And he would, in some cases, torture these believers in an effort to get them to renounce their faith in Jesus. Sometimes they would be killed. Other times they would be dragged and thrown into prison. And eventually, Paul obtains letters from the religious leaders to Jews in Damascus as he went there to bring the Christians. And it was actually, they weren't called Christians. They were called followers of the way back then. So he obtained letters to go to Damascus to arrest these followers of the way and bring them back to Jerusalem in chains to be punished. In his own words in Acts 22, Paul says that I am a Jew born in Tarsus, a city in Cilicia, and I was brought up and educated here in Jerusalem under Gamaliel. As his student, I was carefully trained in our Jewish laws and customs. I became very zealous to honor God in everything I did, just like all of you today, and I persecuted the followers of the way, hounding some to death. Now, this word hounding does not mean how we use it today. It's not the same as your adolescent or your teenager hounding you for something to the point that you just give in because you're tired of arguing with them. Actually, the word that Paul uses here is dioko, which means to follow intensely and to persecute. And so Paul is saying here that I persecuted the followers of the way even to the point of death, even to the point that I had killed them, arresting both men and women and throwing them in prison. And the high priest and the whole council of elders can testify that this is so, for I received letters from them to our Jewish brothers in Damascus, authorizing me to bring followers of the way from there to Jerusalem in chains to be punished. And so Paul was living for the God he knew about, but not for the God that he thought he knew. Does that make sense? Paul knew of God. Paul knew of God, and that is to say that he had knowledge of God, but he didn't know God until he met Jesus. And everything he thought he knew about God was turned upside down the second that he had encountered Jesus. And so how often do we do this? We have knowledge about Jesus, but we don't actually know him. I mean, we may read our Bibles on a regular basis, and truth be told, a large majority of American Christians don't even do that. They do not read their Bible, and that's a problem. Actually, a survey performed by Lifeway Research of 2,900 Protestant churchgoers found that while 90% had said that they desire to please and honor Jesus in all they do, it also found that those same 2,900, only 19% actually read their Bible every day. And to quote Albert Mohler, he said, "We will not believe more than we know, and we will not live higher than our beliefs." I mean, think about that. We will not believe more than we know, and we will not live higher than our beliefs. It's pretty hard to have an encounter with Jesus when we don't purposefully engage in the disciplines that will actually allow us to have an encounter with Jesus. Knowing about Jesus is not the same as knowing Jesus. And many people want to be used by God, but they want it on their terms, without any sacrifice, without having to shift the priorities that it will take for that to be able to happen. And it's easy to look at a man like Paul and say, well, you know, Jesus teed him up for success from the get-go. God even said in Acts chapter 9 that Paul was his chosen instrument to take his message to the Gentiles and to the kings as well as the people of Israel. But the truth is, God didn't tee up Paul. He used him, but he didn't tee him up. Jesus knew the condition of Paul's heart, just like he knew the condition of Matthew's heart when he called him. But Paul was zealous for God. It was just in the wrong manner, and Jesus needed to get his attention. If we look at Acts chapter 9, we see this encounter happen. Speaking of Paul, it says, as he was approaching Damascus on this mission, a light from heaven suddenly shone down around him, and he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" "Well, who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. And the voice replied, "I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men with Saul stood speechless, for they heard the sound of someone's voice, but they saw no one. And so Saul picked himself up off the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he was blind. So his companions led him by the hand to Damascus, and he remained there blind for 3 days. He did not eat, he did not drink. And now there was a believer in Damascus named Ananias. And the Lord spoke to him in a vision, calling, "Ananias!" "Yes, Lord," Ananias replied. And the Lord said, "Go over to Straight Street to the house of Judas. And when you get there, ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul. He is praying to me right now, and I have shown him a vision of a man named Ananias coming and laying hands on him so that he can see again." "But Lord," exclaimed Ananias, "I've heard many people talk about the terrible things this man has done to the believers in Jerusalem, and he is authorized by the leading priest to arrest everyone who calls upon your name." But the Lord said, "Go, for Saul is my chosen instrument to take my message to the Gentiles and to the kings, as well as the people of Israel, and I will show him how much he must suffer for my name's sake." And so Ananias went and found Saul, and he laid his hands on him, and he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And instantly, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he regained his sight. And then he got up and was baptized. And after, he ate some food, and he regained his strength. And so at first glance, it appears that here's Saul, and he's riding down a dusty road, and he encounters Jesus, and he goes blind, and he fasts for a couple of days, and he prays, he gets healed, and then jumps right into ministry to the Gentiles and never looks back. But if we look at the scriptures a little closely, we see that that is not what happened. In fact, in his letter to the Galatians, Paul actually says that he immediately went into Arabia. And in fact, he didn't ever actually return to Jerusalem for 3 years. And so what did Paul do after his encounter with Jesus in Arabia for all this time? Well, a lot of scholars feel that Paul was on a spiritual retreat for a time because he needed to reconcile everything that he knew from the Torah with the new reality that he now found in Jesus. In Arabia, Paul had the opportunity to completely immerse himself in the reality of his Savior and focus on learning and growing in preparation for the ministry that God was preparing him for. You see, Paul had to take everything that he had ever learned about Jewish law, oral tradition, and look past it to the words of the prophets and reconcile all of it to see that the long-awaited Messiah had indeed come, and he was the one that was persecuting his followers. I mean, can you imagine the identity crisis that must have happened to Paul at this point? Here's a man who spent almost his entire life devoted his studying to God, learning the laws, 613 of them, in fact, abiding by those laws, was fervent in his pursuit of God, fervent in his pursuit to preserve his faith, the faith of his culture, fervent in his effort to honor God in everything that he did, only to find out that he completely missed it. And on top of that, he's blind. He's most likely staying in a town, in a house, of both of which he's probably completely unfamiliar with, praying to a God that I can only imagine now he is questioning whether or not he even knows anything about him. And the last thing that Paul saw before losing his sight was Jesus in a completely blinding light. Now, do you think that maybe during this time, being blind and fasting and praying, that maybe Paul had replayed this scene over and over and over again in his head? He didn't eat. He didn't drink. I can't imagine that he slept a whole lot. Praying and replaying that scene on that dusty road over and over again and wondering, how did I miss this? And what have I done? And Jesus, in that moment on the road to Damascus, he questions Saul. He doesn't demand that he stop his persecution, but rather Jesus asks him, why? What is your purpose? What is your aim? What is your goal in all of this? Saul is persecuting Christians because he believes this is God's will. Yet this encounter with Jesus points to the presence of God in Jesus, which is the very last thing Saul was expecting. Saul probably felt that God had already spoken to him, that this is what he was supposed to do. And so he wasn't prepared for Jesus to then speak to him. However, this encounter demonstrates to Paul Jesus' continuing existence and his presence within his followers and the surprising ways in which God makes himself known even when you think you have everything figured out. And at the same time, there's so much beauty in this because here's Paul. He's blind. He's broken. He's immediately dependent on somebody else because he has lost his sight. So let's let that sink in for just a second. So here's Paul. He's riding to Damascus on his horse, probably in the lead position of the men following him. And he's in a position of authority, probably a position that he's very well used to being in. He's going to Damascus. He's on a mission. And then in an instant, he's knocked off his horse on his back immediately in a defensive position. And imagine the feelings of confusion and fear and uncertainty and weakness coming on him just like a sledgehammer. Paul had to learn to be dependent on those that he persecuted as well as dependent on a God that he had to get to know all over again. But it was that dependence that then ignited a flame that ultimately spread Christianity throughout the world. Paul continued his mission of living for God, but he did it with living for the God he knew and not the God that he knew about. And Paul, in Philippians, he sums up his entire life like this. He said, though I could have confidence in my own effort, if anyone could, indeed, if others have reason for confidence in their own efforts, I have even more. I was circumcised when I was 8 days old. I am a pure-blooded citizen of Israel, a member of the tribe of Benjamin, a real Hebrew, if there ever was one. I was a member of the Pharisees, who demand the strictest obedience to Jewish law. I was so zealous that I harshly persecuted the church, and as for righteousness, I obeyed the law without fault. And I once thought these things were valuable, but now I consider them worthless because of what Christ has done. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared to the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage so that I can gain Christ and become one with him. I no longer count on my own righteousness through obeying the law. I no longer count on my own righteousness by obeying the law. Rather, I become righteous through faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with him depends on faith. I once thought these things were valuable, but now I consider them to be worthless because of what Christ has done. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared to the infinite value of knowing Jesus Christ as my Lord. Everything that I have ever done, every success that I have ever experienced, every kudos that was ever given to me is not worth the sweat off the back of a flea when I compare it to the value of knowing Jesus. Do you know Jesus? Or do you know about Jesus? Now, as this video shows, there are so many things that can get in the way of having an encounter with Jesus. Check this out.
Seen you here before.
Yeah, I've never stood to the place where I find peace. I don't know if I'm ready for this.
That'll be fine. Don't you trust me?
I
That'll make it all better.
Whoa, looks like he needs to loosen up a bit.
Back to him, even if you could, do you think he'd even want you after all you've done?
Keeps you from encountering Jesus? For me, it's, you know, as I thought about this and I prayed about this, it's busyness, the need to just be productive or feel productive, television, sometimes pride, discouragement, entitlement. For Paul, it was religion, maybe knowledge, probably some pride. What is it for you? And I'm making a bold ask because I want you to call it out. I'm not asking you to embarrass yourself in this moment, but I am asking you to call out something that keeps you from encountering Jesus. Social media. Bitterness. Escape. Busyness. Discouragement. Exhaustion. Pride. loneliness. If you're watching this online or you're listening, what is it for you? Give it a name. Say it out loud. Bring it to the light. What is it that keeps you from encountering Jesus? We saved worship for the end tonight because I didn't want to call it out and leave, but rather give us an opportunity to repent of these things, to bring them out, to confess them, and ask that our Lord remove them, and then have a time of celebratory worship. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to sing, we're going to worship, pray, and I'll come back up, close us out. Well, James 5:16 says, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. For the earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. And so here's what we're going to do in our C groups this week. We're going to continue to confess to each other, to our home groups, what holds you back from encountering Jesus. And then we're going to pray for each other. If you're not in a home group, come talk to me after service. But as I was thinking about this, we have an absolutely wonderful vision that we believe has been given to us, that Jesus wants to take his church. But if we cannot learn to encounter Jesus, if we allow stuff to get in our way, not saying that all of us do, but if we don't learn to overcome that, we will never fulfill the mission to the full extent that one is possible, and that two would fully glorify Jesus in the fashion in which he deserves. And so I didn't talk to our leadership team before I said this, but I hope in a way that beginning to lay some expectations, beginning to lay some vision forward about what we need to do as a church, because being in very deep relationship with Jesus is the first priority that we've got to make sure that we are doing so that we can continue to move forward and reach the people that Jesus has called us to reach, not only in this neighborhood, but in this city. And we've had some very wonderful revelations that have been spoken to us about what this church is to accomplish. And we firmly believe that it's time to start walking towards that. And so I want you to join me. I want you to join us. So Lord, we put this up to you. We want to be church that worships you above all else. We want to be a church that is so amazingly on fire, Lord, for worshiping you, for loving you, for being what you are about, for having the same attitude as you. And Lord, I'm so thankful for the courage and the boldness of those that were willing to speak up and say, here's what holds me back. And I pray for each and every one of those. I heard bitterness and loneliness and exhaustion and escape and pride and social media, or just different facets about things that block us from getting to you. Lord, help us to lay those down. Help us to engage you more fully. Help us as a church, Lord, to move forward, to carry out the mission that you have called us to, Lord. There's an amazing world of people out there that don't yet know you, but we hope soon and pray soon will. And we want them to worship under the banner that is Jesus. Lord, we give you praise. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name. And everybody said in agreement, amen.